Our next speaker will be Dr. Lauren Thomas. She is assistant professor, clinical assistant professor with the animal science faculty in Fayetteville. And her topic is anaplasmosis in beef cattle.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Lauren Thomas, and I'm a clinical assistant professor here at the University of Arkansas Department of Animal Science. And I'm going to talk to you today about anaplasmosis in beef cattle. I'm going to talk to you about what anaplasmosis is and what some of the symptoms are that you can look for, some of the treatments that can be employed, some management considerations for you to think about, and then a little bit of information on what we've been working on here over the last few breeding seasons at the Batesville station. So hang tight, and we'll get started here shortly. Anaplasmosis is an infectious disease caused by the microorganism Anaplasma marginale. This disease was formerly known as gall sickness. It's common in tropical and subtropical regions of the world. The southeastern United States is classified as a subtropical region, so it is a common disease agent in our region and can affect not only cattle, but also sheep and goats and buffalo, as well as some wild ruminants. Interestingly enough, all ages of cattle are susceptible to anaplasmosis, but it's the mature adults that more often are most likely to show symptoms associated with this disease. So let's talk a little bit more about the Anaplasma marginale organism. So this is the causative agent of anaplasmosis. The Anaplasma marginale organism is technically considered to be a rickettsial parasite of cattle, meaning it is an intracellular parasite that likes to infect red blood cells specifically. And the organism is primarily transmitted by ticks in the environment. The American dog tick or the dermacentor tick is the primary tick in our region that transmits the disease. Other methods of transmission from cows, one cow to another, can occur between or amongst biting flies. So in the summer, fly control is going to be really important in minimizing this disease, as well as mechanical transfer via our veterinary instruments. And so that includes our scalpel blades, that includes needles, that includes ear taggers. So anything that can potentially cause bleeding in an animal or be contaminated with blood can also be a source of infection. So this is an organism that infects red blood cells, and it's the transmission of blood via the bite wound of a tick. So through the saliva, the bite of a tick or a fly or a needle that can transmit the organism. When an animal gets infected with this organism, again, it infects the red blood cells and causes destruction of those cells. Infection with Anaplasma marginale can lead to significant economic impacts and can result in increased cull rates within a herd, as well as 20 to 30% loss in body weight in individuals that are infected, abortions, and acute death. The symptoms of anaplasmosis can vary depending on the age of the animal. If the calf is less than a year of age, you may not notice any symptoms at all. The calf may appear completely normal and not show any signs of illness. If it's a yearling or an animal that's between 1 and 2 years of age, you may notice moderate to severe symptoms. However, these animals are most commonly misdiagnosed as having pneumonia, and we'll explain why here in a second. Older cattle are the ones that are going to suffer the most severe symptoms and often succumb to this disease. Symptoms that you may notice include depression, anorexia. Anorexia just means lack of appetite, so going off feed, fever. If you can get close enough, you may notice pale or yellow mucous membranes. So this is around the mouth and the nose, around the whites of the eyes. And then if it's a female, the inside of her vulva may appear pale in color or yellow in color. These animals may have an elevated respiratory rate, as well as decreased milk production if they're in lactation. And then obviously, as we mentioned before, abortion, if they're pregnant, and then sudden death. Now, all of these symptoms that you see listed here are a direct result of the severe anemia or loss of functional red blood cells due to the destruction of the red blood cells in the animal by the anaplasma organism. And so if you've got a low red blood count, if you've got severe anemia, that's going to cause an elevated respiratory rate and depression. And so you can see how in these yearling heifers, it's most commonly misdiagnosed as pneumonia. If you have an animal that dies acutely, you can perform an animal autopsy, which is also known as a necropsy, or your veterinarian may want to perform a necropsy. Necropsies are most useful if the animal has died within the last 24 hours. So if it's a fresh carcass, you're going to get better information than if it is an older carcass. Things that we look for on necropsy include evidence of anemia, so those pale mucous membranes that I was talking about, as well as thin and watery blood. Jaundiced membranes and tissue, so a yellow coloring of the skin, the gums, the eyes, and generally the fat and abdomen can appear bright yellow, which is what you see in the picture there. If you can identify the spleen and the liver, you may notice an enlarged spleen and then a mottled yellow orangey colored liver and then a distended gallbladder. So how do we diagnose this disease? Well, if you want to attempt to diagnose it, I would highly recommend that you consult with your veterinarian to determine the best samples to collect and the tests to request. Most often, you're going to want to collect a serum sample, which is a type of blood sample, but it's a blood sample that's collected in what's called a red top tube. A red top tube is literally a blood tube that has a red top and does not have any anticoagulant in it, meaning the sample will clot in the tube and then you'll get a yellow straw-colored liquid that'll separate from that sample. And that serum is where we find antibodies. Those are the proteins that the immune system generates to fight infection. And so you can do what's called, or you can have what's called a C. ELISA test performed on that serum sample to determine if there are antibodies floating around in the bloodstream specific to anaplasma. This is the most cost-efficient test that you can do per animal at roughly $7 per head. You can also collect a whole blood sample in a purple top tube, and a purple top tube contains anticoagulant, so a substance that prevents the blood from clotting and keeps the blood in suspension, and those samples will be submitted for DNA testing via a test called PCR. This is a much more expensive test at $25 per head, but can be a more sensitive test or a more specific test for ruling anaplasma in or out of your animal or your herd. So your vet in some scenarios may recommend a PCR to truly confirm an active infection. But again, it's a more expensive test. So most producers are going to go with the serum test initially. So if you do suspect or diagnose anaplasmosis within your herd or within a single animal or a group of animals in your herd, what can you do to treat it? Well, the first thing you want to think about, and you want to carefully think about this, is separation of infected animals from the rest of the herd. Remember, this disease is passed from one animal to another through biting insects or blood-feeding insects like ticks and flies. And so if you have an infected animal, that animal can serve as a source of infection to others in your herd through the flies and the ticks in the environment. So separating sick animals or affected animals might be the first step, but the problem you run into is the severe anemia can lead to complications when trying to move those animals. So any physical exertion or excitement of the affected animal can lead to acute death. Again, you want to consult with your veterinarian, but a single antibiotic injection with LA-200 may help to reduce some of the severity of the disease and some of the symptoms associated with the disease. Full recovery takes anywhere from 2 to 3 months, and pregnant cows may still abort. Bulls can be infertile for up to 1 year post-infection. So again, as you consider your treatment and prevention options, you'll want to consult with your local veterinarian. The addition of CTC or chlorotetracycline to feed or free choice mineral may be useful to you. And in times of the year where there are lots of flies and ticks in the environment, you may want to consider pulse therapy 30 days on, 30 days off with CTC in the feed or in the mineral. CTC, however, is not available OTC anymore, and you do have have to have a veterinary feed directive that will authorize or basically prescribe that antibiotic for your feed formulation. So again, consult with your veterinarian about CTC if you think you've got an anaplasmosis problem. Another thing is the vaccination. There is a vaccination available for anaplasmosis. However, it is a conditional use. It's been released on a conditional use license through the USDA and is available through a group called University Products LLC of Baton Rouge. It's important to note that the vaccination does not prevent infection. However, it may help to minimize symptoms. Again, the vaccination has not been fully approved, but it is available on a conditional basis through the powers that be in the government. So that may be an option that you'll want to consider, but again, talk to your veterinarian. Note that any animal who recovers from clinical disease will be a carrier of the organism for life. So even if they overcome the disease, they never completely clear the organism out of their system. And so these animals, again, serve as a potential source of infection for naive animals in the group. And so you do have to weigh the risk versus the benefit of maintaining those animals in your herd. So if you are in an area or have a herd with a low infection rate for anaplasmosis, you might want to consider culling the carrier animals and just getting them out of your herd completely. Another good tip is to pre-screen any and all new herd additions if you have a herd with a currently low infection rate. Maintain good external parasite control. So fly control and tick control are going to be important at preventing this disease. Also, you can change your injection needles after every animal during vaccination administration. I know the general rule has been to vaccinate 10 animals at a time and then change your needle after every 10th animal. But if animal number one has anaplasmosis as a carrier for the organism, if you get blood on your needle, then you can accidentally infect the 9 other animals behind her by using that same needle on those animals. So it's really best if you're changing your needle in between each animal. So a fresh needle for every animal. And purchase a sharps container. This is a great way to dispose of those extra needles. It keeps them out of the environment, makes your life a whole lot easier. It's basically a special plastic box that you can throw the needles in and then dispose of accordingly. You can talk to your veterinarian about getting one of these, or you can order them online through veterinary suppliers. Also think about your ear taggers, your implant guns, and your castration equipment. Anything that can get blood on it that can be contaminated with one animal's blood, you want to be careful not to use that or get that blood in the bloodstream of another animal. So cleaning that equipment between each animal is going to be helpful to you in minimizing the risk of passing infection on from one animal to another. So what have we been working on the last few years at Batesville? Well, in 2019, some of you may be aware that we did a statewide surveillance looking at roughly 60 different herds. That was our goal. And looking at the overall prevalence of the organism, of the disease in our cattle across the state. And we divided the state up into different geographical regions. And we found that those regions, the infection rate in the cattle of those regions ranged anywhere from 36% to almost 94% of animals being infected. Of all of the herds that we tested, 56 out of the 58 herds had at least one animal that tested positive for anaplasma. So it is out there. It's just some areas have more animals affected than others. So we confirmed that anaplasma marginalis is indeed endemic to Arkansas. Now we just need to determine what to do with that information. So we have that information. It's good information. But the research that we've been working on the last couple of years and will continue to work on in 2022 is a more intense evaluation of anaplasmic carriers in the following traits in affected cows and calves. So looking at those carrier animals and determining whether or not they have an increased rate of abortion, what their body condition scores are before and after calving, what their calf birth weights are and calf weaning weights. We know that calves can that are born to carrier cows can actually be born infected with Anaplasma marginale. And so we're interested in determining whether or not we see a difference in birth weight and weaning weight as a result. And data analysis is still pending. So as you can see, we're going to be continuing to work on this and collect data in this area in spring calvers this next year. And so we will hopefully have more information for you on this in the months to come. But all of our samples that we collect, we actually do send to Kansas State for further DNA testing. And Kansas State is specifically looking at individual strains of Anaplasma. So depending on where the samples come from, there are genetic variations in the Anaplasma organism. And so that information is going to be helpful for the development of future vaccines that are targeted more specifically and going to be more efficacious towards preventing infection with this organism. So some exciting stuff is going on. And so we hope that you'll stay tuned to what is to come in the future. So thank you so much for your attention. I know we'll take questions at the end of all the presentations today, but thanks for letting me share this information with you today. I hope you got something out of it.